What's going on, everybody? This is Fry. So today we are redoing in 2023 the tier list for the Kabloom class. Let's just get right into it. I'm going to be going through the Kabloom plants one at a time, and we're going to start off with an amazing card. It is Puff Shroom. Puff Shroom is an S tier card. This is actually one of the really most useful cards in the game because it is a zero cost card. So let me tell you about the usefulness. Obviously, playing it together with Puff Shroom, because it's a free 2-2. That's really good stats. Free 1-1, not so much, but you know, it also has team up. Together with Pineclone, it's going to be a free 3-3, which is really good. Together with Gloomshroom, you know, again, Gloomshroom, if you don't have any mushrooms on the field, Gloomshroom is only playable on turn 6. It can shroom for 2 Gloomshroom, but Puffshroom enables you to do that combo on turn 5. This Puffshroom itself represents like 9 damage maximum on the field, can field clear, can kill up to 3 minions. It's really good with Solar Flare with Cobb Cannon because, again, it is a team up. So besides for the cards that it works very well together with, Elderberry, Cro-Magnolia, there's so many countless cards, Stormfront, which gives all your guys a 1-1 as a superpower. So besides for all of those, there is a second use out of Puffshroom that people don't realize, and that it is actually a very powerful aggro card, because you can put this in front of any of your other aggro cards you're running, whether it be a Haunted Pumpkin or a Blooming Heart, or even an Astracado. This protects your cards from dying. So it's almost, think of it as the way the Discord guys kind of described this in Little Buddy, which was very smart, is think of this as an escape through time, which protects your minion and costs 0. Obviously, it's not quite as reliable, but it is pretty reliable. If you put a team up in front of something, that thing is not going to die during the attack phase. The Puffshroom, which costs 0, will die instead. Not only that, but this adds attack. So if you're to play Haunted Pumpkin with a Puffshroom in front of it, instead of doing 4 damage, now you're doing 5, which in an aggro deck, adding in that free damage is actually very effective. Extremely good card, not just in mushroom decks, but in any deck that needs little cards, little swarming cards, or an aggro. It's also very useful. Easy S tier. Next thing I'm going to do is Astro Shroom, of course. Astro Shroom. Okay, I just want to reiterate the time to use Astro Shroom. I'm going to start off by putting it in B tier. It definitely has its uses. Very essential card for a cycle cap, which I think that now that people understand, whenever they see a nightcap, they have to quickly mulligan for your environments and basically play around cycle cap, since it's probably one of the most common nightcap decks. Cycle cap, you know, I used to say was the best deck in the game. It really has gone down just because people know how to deal with it. But Astro Shroom, it can be useful, let's say, in swarm decks. The thing you don't want to do with Astro Shroom is just spam it on the field on turn 1, because then it doesn't get a whole lot of value. It's just a 1-cost, 1-1 terrible stats. And maybe you'll be able to play 1-2 minions after it. And it's just doing a little bit of bullseye to face. Astro Shroom is much better when you save it for the late game and sort of as a finisher in a deck that is able to utilize that and has a lot of, let's say, swarm cards. You don't end up with a lot of, you know, early game cards in the late game in order to use this effectively as a finisher. But every once in a while you can find a deck that is really good. Cycle Cap, even like the OTK Dandelion King deck, if you want to see that, we did with Solar Flare. This was a useful finisher because if you, again, do enough damage to your opponent's face, there's very little they can do if you have Astro Shroom and Pup Shroom and a lot of little Shroom for twos. Combine it like that. So make sure you're not playing this too early. Make sure you're getting a lot of value on the board before they're able to react to a 1-1. It's decent. I'm putting it in B because it's not one of the, it's not an amazing card, but it is decent. It has some very solid uses in this game. Banana Bomb's really gonna be a hard one for me to rate. It seems like it's an amazing card. I don't use it a whole lot. But the fact that it can answer basically anything they play on turn 1, it doesn't answer, you know, some of the biggest threats in the game, which are going to be Con Man and Headstone Carver on the zombie side, but it'll answer pretty much anything else that is dangerous. The other cool thing about Banana Bomb is that it just finishes off opposing zombies. If you make a bad trade and you're missing 1 or 2 damage, really useful for that. I'm not really sure where to put this. It's either low A tier or high B tier. I'm going to go with my gut and actually put it in high B tier. Because it is sort of outclassed by Berry Blast that does 3 damage and can also go face. And it's a little bit more of a reliable option at 2 cost than this is at 1 cost. But a very actual solid card. I'm never going to yell at people for running Banana Bombs, just even extra, in almost any deck. Because you can, again, finish off really dangerous threats that only have 1 or 2 health left. Blooming Heart's a really powerful aggro card. Obviously, it's an essential part of aggro Solar Flare. Very important part of even decks like the Captain Combustible deck, the Pine Boss, I think it was called, or Repeat Moss Boss, I don't remember what it was called. It's a good addition to any deck. It's a one cost card that grows by itself without any additional input, and this becomes a really big threat. It's a must answer card. Again, it's probably low A or high B. I'm gonna put it in low A. I'm putting this higher than Astrishim because it just has more uses. It's gonna be an essential in every single aggro deck. Astrishim is very few decks that it actually is very good in. Puff Shroom, Button Shroom, unfortunately, it's just going in F tier. No explanation needed. It's a one cost 1/1. Here's a very underrated card too, High Voltage Current. Whenever I run this, it just does amazing. Besides for in berry decks, you can use this obviously with Conjure, Captain Combustible, but this can also activate Dino Roars. It's a one cost card that just makes a berry, and it can also, so it's a one cost card, very cheap. It has a high potential to grow because all your berries, including a second High Voltage Current, including the card it conjures, makes it grow. It also is triggering Dino Roars. It's kind of like a free card. It doesn't cost you a card. Really like High Voltage Current. It's another one of these tough ones. I think based on my experience with it, it is a B, but because I don't think I use this enough, and I think this is actually a very good inclusion with a lot of other decks. All right, I'll put it in B. Hot Lava, it really just does not do enough for a planned environment. Planned environments, of course, are always worse because when you play this, the zombie can has last save for environments and can cover it. Not an incredibly useful card, especially because it hits your own things. It can't be more than D or F. I mean, I never play this. I'm putting an F. Screw it. Not worth it. Poison Shroom. Just running this as a one cost environment. It just doesn't get enough value. It doesn't justify inclusion in your deck. That's the problem with Hot Lava. Poison Shroom, very poor stats. It is an aggro card because it can do 3 damage for one cost, which is a lot. But the thing that is important about aggro cards is that when they stick a zombie in front of it, that zombie will die. That's why Haunted Pumpkin and even things like Zapricot, Applesauce or things with naturally high attack, they're able to remove whatever they play in front of it, unless they're investing a huge zombie, in which case, if you're playing aggro, you're winning. This one does not remove the zombie that is placed in front of it, which means they have a lane clogged, which is definitely the way that you defend against aggro decks. It can be useful, let's say, in like budget aggro Solar Flake, and you can use this, but it's not a super useful card, and it's kind of hard to imagine this being top tier in any situation, even in mushroom decks. I don't run this. It just does not do enough. I'm putting it in D tier, although I do suggest to you could run it in like budget aggro Solar Flare, and basically that's it. Hot Lava and Berry Control, yeah. Again, maybe there is a good deck for Hot Lava, but where you play your Hibernating Berry on the field and then you stick it on top with Spadown. Maybe I'll try that someday. Reincarnation, you know, the reason why I'm redoing all these tier lists in 2023 is because there have been a few cards that I have really, really changed my opinion about in the last 3 years. And Reincarnation is definitely on the top of that list in terms of how useful we found this card to be. This used to just be considered, you know, a meme card, something you run in an RNG deck. But at the end of the day, Reincarnation is actually a really powerful card in competitive decks. I even included in like mid Solar Flare, which is one of the more competitive decks in this game, in my opinion. The key to Reincarnation, obviously, has a very wacky ability how it turns into a random plant, so it's a little bit unreliable, but that plant gets a 1/1. That where the slot that this fills in a deck is turn one removal. If they are playing Con Man, Cheese Cutter, Headstone Carver, those must answer turn one cards, the Reincarnation does deal with them. Even a, you know, a Con Man will survive that turn, but they will trade unless they invest another card into it. And that is the slot it fills. The cool thing about this Reincarnation, though, is that most of your one cost cards become very bad in the late game. If you're running, let's say, you know, Blooming Heart, this is not a good card to play on turn five. It's just too slow. You'd rather be getting this late game powerful card. The cool thing then about Reincarnation is that every turn it turns into a powerful card. Usually, this is not turning into a one drop, it's turning even into a two drop. Then it gets the stats are buffed 1/1. This is usually like really, really good. Again, it's not reliable. Sometimes you also, with Reincarnation, Just on turn two, it'll turn into a two drop that has buff stats, and it's just so much tempo. It could just be like a 4-3 apple saucer. Turn three, it could just be turning into like a bigger version of anyway, a half decent card. Almost any card in the game, if you add 1-1 to it, it's kind of OP. Even like the really bad cards, they become decent when you add 1-1 to it at the same cost. But yeah, so this is a early game removal card that actually does do a lot. It's a highly impactful card when it comes to the late game because of its buff. I'm putting in an A tier. Right? It's got to be A tier, right? It's super. I'm gonna stick it in A tier. I think that's where it belongs. Shroomfur 2, really versatile card. You're mostly going to be doing this with Pine Clones because you can get obviously two, you know, one cost, you get 2 3/3s. Obviously works very well with Crow Magnolia that gives your cards, all your cards a buff. It can end up doing a lot of attack. It works okay with Molokale just straight because then for a one cost, you're getting a two drop and a one drop teamed up after you transform both of those into cards that cost one more. It does also create this team up, so it's just a good base for Cob Cannon, good base for Elderberry. You end up with like a little team up in front, like a built-in protection when you're using Elderberry, of course, on the back one. Very good card to, for the same reason, to use with Gloomshroom. It's so useful and so versatile in a lot of decks. Any deck that buffs multiple minions, this is auto include. I'm gonna put it in A tier. It might be an S tier. It's either high A tier or low S tier, but honestly, I think Puff Shroom's the better card. We'll reserve S tier for Puff Shroom, guys. Velociraptor Hatchling, we found really one deck for this. It's a Spadao deck that runs Photosynthesizer and Triceratops and has a lot of dinosaurs, and you're always using Photosynthesizer. You kind of need to buff the health of this. It doesn't, you know, it starts off slow. It starts off only with one attack, unlike, let's say, Blooming Heart that, you know, starts off with two attack, which is a big difference in terms of the opponent's block meter, how much damage it's doing. Again, you need, you know, to draw, if you're only drawing one card per turn, which is usually the case, then this is just a worse Blooming Heart. If you're even drawing extra cards, it's just a slower Blooming Heart that can speed up and sometimes ramp up. Mostly it's good with Photosynthesizer. It was pretty good in one deck. I'm going to give it in C tier because it did have a very solid use again in the Dino Roar deck for Spadao. I think it was the Starch Lord package or whatever it was for Spadao. Love running it together with Guardian package with the Photosynthesizers and stuff because it's just a one cost card that can end up having 5, 6, 7 attack if you're drawing things. All right, Banana Launcher. I mean, this is a card that has been, you know, a lot of people around the community have been saying this is amazing. I've seen this pop off. I mean, this is a must answer two cost card because if they don't answer it, it's giving a free Banana Bomb, which is a decent card in itself, every single turn. I've never had success running Banana Launcher ever. And the flaw of Banana Launcher, of course, if you put it on the field and they put, you know, they answer it with, let's say, a Beam Me Up or a Summoning. Or they put, you know, the next turn, they put, let's say the next turn even, they put a 3-3 in front of it, which the Banana Bomb is not going to be able to kill. So this will die for free. The Banana Launcher dies for free against a card with 3 attack, and you basically have a 3-cost Banana Bomb that's maybe blocked a little bit of face damage from the minion that's killed it. And a 3-cost Banana Bomb is not good enough value. This is only good if it starts making 2-3, and I haven't seen it do it reliably. I've seen it happen to me. There must be something I'm missing about this card. It's low B, high C. I think because I've seen other people use this effectively, and it's just a card I haven't been able to figure out. I'm going to give it the benefit of the doubt of B tier. I really hope I figure out good decks for a banana. I feel like I'll play the same deck and I'll play in the same way, but it just, I don't know. Banana Launcher just never does it for me, but I'll put it in B. A compromise. Compromise B. Berry Blast. I mean, needless to say, this is an S tier card. It is so versatile. 3 damage is such a key amount of damage in terms of how many minions have 3 health in this game. The fact this can also go face, which can either finish off an opponent with 3 health or proc the block if they have a full block meter and set up a bigger burst of damage, makes it just auto include in every single deck. This is probably the most just auto brainless, put this in every single deck, whether it's aggro, whether it's tempo, because it's it's a tempo card or it's control. I can't say enough about Barry Bless, but yeah, I mean, as a common card, just put four of those into literally every single deck. It's very rare to find a Kabloom deck that I don't run four. Sometimes I'll run three, but even that, that's very rare. All right, Buff Shrimp. So here's a card we've actually been trying just the last few days. So if you look in Frime Up Gaming in the few recent videos kind of right before this one, particularly there was a Nightcap deck that we did with Mushrooms. I found Buff Shrimp to actually be a pretty decent card in the following scenario. You have to, obviously, if you play, let's say, Shroom for 2 on turn 1 and then Buff Shroom on turn 2, that's a bunch of 2-2s going to be on the field. It's buffing all your Buff Shrooms. Add in a Puff Shroom and you have like a, you know, a huge field already on turn 2. This can also buff, again, other Mushrooms around the game. Everything from Sporticus, giving that a little bit extra stats, to Gloomshroom. This can get a lot of value. If you're forcing yourself to play this, let's say, on turn 2 together with a Shroom for 2, it's not going to be reliable. So the key to this card that I found is to make late-game combos. If you're playing a couple Shroom for 2s, or you're playing a Shroom for 2 plus a 3-cost Mushroom, and then you're playing the Buff Shroom, let's say, all on turn 6, you can sometimes set up this big value field that way, especially if you're ramping. But that's just the way that we're sort of learning to play Buff Shroom. I definitely want to try this more with Captain Combustible, maybe in a deck with Vegetation Mutation and the Shroom for 2s. In the meantime, almost as a placeholder, I'm going to put this in B tier, because I am actually seeing, for budget players, this is actually pretty decent. And, you know, budget player aggro like Mushroom decks, some of the first cards, like, it's a common card, so one of the first cards you can really use to get early game power. But I think this has a lot of, we've even had some experimenting playing Imitator into Buff Shroom, which is a 5-cost combo and makes all of your Mushrooms then into 3/3s, which is like a whole Pine Clone situation. So definitely looking forward to discovering more value out of Buff Shroom, but we've had some pretty decent decks with it, so I'll put it in B tier. Next comes Fireweed. This is a card I've been using less actually over the years. This is definitely part of, let's say, aggro Solar Flare. 2-cost 3/2 is good aggro stat, so that's why I run this in aggro Solar Flare. I consider it better than the unreliable Fireweed on the reliable berry, whatever it's called, wild berry, that only has one health and is very easy to die. The Fireweed, obviously the other thing, it makes Hot Lava, which, you know, I put in F tier because to run Hot Lava itself does not justify a card, you know, running that as a card in your deck. But this does have a second use out of covering your opponent's environments. I've definitely started putting less emphasis on environments since they came into the game a few years ago. I don't think it's important to run environments in every single deck, particularly plant environments that can be covered on that same turn by zombie environments, not as important. I still think Fireweed is a really good card. It's very versatile. If you run a couple of these in the deck just to counter opponents' environments, you're going to get value. And worst case scenario, it's a 2-cost 3/2 if you play it on Heights. This can also remove, you know, this trades very high, because if you play this in front of a card with 5 health, it's going to do 3 plus 1 plus 1 from the Hot Lava. Is actually going to be do up to five damage. I'm going to put this, I'll put it in A tier. I probably put this in S before. Well, it used to be a 3/3. But I'll put it in A tier because it's a very versatile card. It's a very powerful card in a lot of decks. Next, we're going to run Seedlings. Poor Seedling. It dies for free. It only has one health. And even when it does transform, they really just need to make this card not transform into things that cause 0/1. It at least has to turn into its cost, which is 2 or more. I don't know why this is even capped at 6. Makes this thing turn, you know, as such a high risk card, why not be the higher reward that can turn into a Cornucopia or an 8-drop? In the meantime, poor Seedling. I'm putting it in D. Poor Seedling, regrettably putting it in D tier, if I'm being absolutely honest and serious. Shelf Mushroom. This is it's an interesting card. This actually used to be a 2/3, and I wish it still had that stats. I sort of understand why it was nerfed, because this can be placed in front of a 2/3 and then end up representing 2 damage the next turn. So it's almost like 2 cards for the price of 1. This trading with something with only 1 attack is so unlikely. Not a very good card even in berry decks. I'd say the cool use of this is playing Strawberrying on top of it, because then it's doing 2 damage plus giving you an extra Berry Blast in your hand. Not a very good card overall. Put it in D tier. Wildberry, you can include this in aggressive decks only. The fact it moves lanes is actually a disadvantage. If this was just a card of 4-1... Sorry. If it was just a 4-1, I would be giving it a higher tier. But the fact that it actually moves means you can't control what lane it goes into. And sometimes they'll even have, you know, a trap or territory, or even worse, a total eclipse on the board that does one damage and just reduces its health to zero immediately. Makes it a very unreliable card. It does have its uses. I'll put it in C tier because for budget players, it could be used in aggro decks. Very angry. So, okay, here's another card. We've had a couple. I should really be making more very angry decks. This is a very obviously high potential card if you have a big field, but it's very circumstantial in terms of getting a ton of value from it. You have to have, for this to be justified, like at least three cards on the field, and it's pretty expensive at three costs too. We've had some success with decks with very angry and then Sunstrike. I don't even remember what we're using this for. Not a very extremely useful card though. I'm going to put this in D tier, but I hope that we can find more decks with Very Angry because it's a fun card, and maybe. Cosmic Mushroom, it's hard to find a place for this in any deck because of the 3-cost sun. I kind of wish this card cost 2. If you look at 2, this would be not even like an amazing card, but be okay. But 3-cost, putting a 2-2 on the field, and then you're getting a Mushroom that gets a buff, but who knows what that Mushroom's going to be if it's a Ringleader. If it's a, you know, if you're getting a puff shroom out of this every time, it'll actually be really good. 3-1, 0 cost. But it's not giving you reliably good cards. It's hard to, where are you going to put this in a mushroom deck? There's just so much better cards like Punish Room and things to be running in mushroom decks. The Conjure, it's just so expensive for a card that is to be run in a Conjure deck. You'd rather be running one drops like the High Voltage Current. I'm putting it in D tier. Not a super useful card. Cro-Magnolia, so we've had some success with this, running it with, like, early game Swarm. You can even run this in the same deck as Pineclone, and after you play Pineclone, put a Cro-Magnolia and buff everything, buff your very wide board. Growing by 2 attack. It doesn't add health to your plants, though, and I feel like that's the detriment of it. I almost wish this would add, like, 1-1 to everything. And this itself would be then a 3-5, and it would add 1-1 to everything around the field just to give them a little bit extra sustain. Adding attack to things, not adding health, usually means those things can still get deleted just as easily. It's a useful card in some decks. I'll give it B tier, though, because we have built decks around and have had some success. If you want to see those again, just go to... just type in Frime Up Gaming, Cro-Magnolia, and you'll see. Imitator, oh man, here's a card that we have found so freaking useful. In the mid decks, this is a 1-4, so it's a very difficult card to remove on turn 3. Even on turn 4, there's not a whole lot of answers to a 1-4, you know, unless they're really looking for it. It is a little bit high risk because, again, of the low stats, it's pinging the block meter, but not even that high risk. And the reward of this is tremendous. It's essentially a 3-cost card that can turn into anything in the game. We run this in the mid decks, so the mid decks are going to be running a lot of cards that cost either 4, very often more like 5. Just be able to get a second Gloomshroom when you play Gloomshroom. When we do it with Solar, you know, in mid Solar Flare, in that deck, you can either get a second Astrocado, a second Allosaurus, like these really solid cards that are big. And again, it's not they're not going to reliably be answering your Imitator all in one turn. We've had a lot of success with that. You can also even use it with Buff Shroom to get a second Buff Shroom on the field. You can use it with Click Pea to get 2 Click Peas. They're both going to be 3/3s. So that's a net of a 4-cost, including the Click Pea, a 4-cost 2/3/3s, which is pretty decent. It's basically 2 2-cost 3/3s, which is very good stats. Ton of uses in the game. I'll put it really in the same sort of tier as Reincarnation in terms of being super, super useful in a lot of decks. It's not just a few decks. There's not just like a couple of, you know, things. We've had Imitator, we've had so much success with it, copying the bigger, any deck with bigger plants. You can really, it as a setup play for bigger plants. Invasive Species, it's tough because 3-2-4 is not good stats. Obviously 5-4 is good, but it needs to be in an environment. I've also lowered again the I feel like the value of plant environments. I've been realizing it's lower than I thought. You can use it with Coffee Grounds. We've tried that before. I haven't really seen the great use of it in invasive species. We've had maybe one deck with it, and it wasn't even that good. I'll put it in D tier. Mushroom Grotto is a very expensive environment for what it does. If you play something into it, they usually just, well, if you play a Shroom for two into this environment, they'll just leave the Shroom for two be there. So this basically is three cost two, and it makes two Puff Shrooms, which is too expensive for what it does. Obviously, if they, for some reason they keep removing the cards that you play into this, or you're playing must answer cards, so it can get continuous value. But again, it's a three cost plan environment that gets answered by every single zombie environment. That costs three or less the turn it's played. Not a super duper good card. Sometimes you play this into like a big Pine Clone play, but you have to play this on turn four, then play Shroom for two Pine Clone on turn five, and it creates a whole bunch of Pine Clones then. Not a great environment. I'll put it in C tier though, it has its uses. Mushroom Ringleader, being a three cost card with one health, that has a such a needy condition for it to be any good. It has to have at least other plants. It doesn't even count itself as a plant. So for this to even be more than a 4-1, it needs to be three other plants on the field, and then only has one health. Like if this had three health, this would be a good card, but even two. But in the meantime, I'm putting in an F tier. There's just never really never found a good use. Poison Ivy's decent. We run in Aggro Solar Flare. It does a lot of damage for a three cost card, and when it gets covered, then you can put something else on top of it, like an Elderberry, particularly with Solar Flare. Even running this, I think we've had success running this with Captain Combustible, of just having, then you can remove the card they play in front of this, and five damage is a lot. It also has three health, which makes it, for again, for a three drop, it's on par, not a really easy card to remove. I will put it in B tier. Punish Room, so we've been finding some uses for this in the mushroom decks, but it's not incredibly useful. I feel like it's even iffy even in the mushroom decks with Buff Shroom, because it's a three cost 2/2. It dies really easily, and it's a little bit unreliable in terms of how it gets its value. It needs your other mushrooms to die before it, a three cost 2/2, dies. I'll put in C tier. It's either high D or low C. I'll put in like low C tier. Strawberryan is only useful in berry decks. This can be very useful. Berry decks are just kind of eh, but this can be useful. It can end up, it's mostly good against like swarm decks that have very low health zombies. Against high health zombies, pretty useless. It's very hard to also find a berry to put this on top of, to get the berry blast. I guess high voltage currents. Okay, I'll put it in C tier. Velociraptor Hunters is a very good card. I mean, it's incredible stats for a three cost card. It creates two minions, but just after a couple of turns, this is already doing six damage. Since both of the cards are growing with every single Dino Roar, you're able to, and then when the front one dies, the back one is still a beast and it's still growing. Really, really versatile card. It's either low S tier or high A tier. You can also play this. It combos well with Pine Clone, because honestly, a three cost 2/3/3s is really good. You can play it into Molokale because it's three cost, then 2/5 2/4 drops, which teamed up, which is really good. I'm gonna put it in high A tier, because it's a really versatile card, and it's I'm not putting an S tier, because really, if I find that when I get this late in games, you're playing this on turn five, it's kind of like, it's too slow. It's only doing two damage non-bullseye that turn, but very useful, very versatile card. Zapricot, basically only useful in Aggro Solar Flare, but it's decent, so we'll put it in. It's kind of just that one deck though. I guess you can run this in an aggro like Captain Combustible deck too. Should I put in the same thing as Poison Ivy? I think it's a little worse than Poison Ivy. I'll put it in C. Molokale, so a really fun card, obviously. Not bad as a competitive card, because you can turn your Pine Clones into five drops. You can also turn any of your big cards once they get damaged. Like once you play, let's say, a Gloomshroom on the field and it takes a few damage, okay. So now it's only a 5/2. You actually heal it by launching this and turning it into a six drop. So we've had a lot of success turning your big cards into bigger cards. Yeah, I've had some success playing this with Pear Paradise, and you get two Molokales, which double launches everything. But mostly this is going to be used in conjunction with Velociraptor Hunter to turn them into four drops, and with Pine Clones, turn all your little Pine Clones into five drops. I'll give it just a competitive rating. Competitively. Honestly, I'm putting an A tier competitively, because it's very, very good in a lot of decks and pretty good in some. That's why I'm putting it, let's say, higher than Astro Shroom, which I feel like is really good in a couple decks and then completely useless otherwise. Molokale has more, again, that's really what I'm rating is, this is more useful and has more applications in this game. Not just Pine Clone, but also all these mid decks are actually pretty good with. It's either high B tier or low A tier, it doesn't really matter. Pair of Pairs just doesn't really do enough for four, it's creating 2/2/2s. Unless you have another card that's going to buff this, it's just not doing anything on the field. It could deal forward damage, but it's just not enough for a four-cost card. We'll put that in D tier. I don't know. Should we go Pair Pairs, Molokale? Maybe it's a thing. You guys think it should be an F? I think it's actually a much better card than the cards we have in F tier. It's basically on par with the D tier cards. Pair Paradise. Okay, so a bit of a meme card. It's a four-cost plant environment enough set. That's why it's not a good card. We have had a ton of success with this, with decks that control really well, and then set this up either, you know, with Molokale, like I mentioned, you play that just all on turn 8 so they cannot answer it, and then buffs everything, leaps everything twice. It's a bit of a meme. You can use this with setting up for Dandelion King for... You know, the reason this isn't as good as Imitator, first of all, four costs, but also it's an environment. So a one-cost zombie environment destroys this. A one-cost card, the only one-cost card in the game that destroys Imitator is Rolling Stone, I think. It's a bit of a meme, but it actually has some uses. Same tier as Mushroom Grotto? I think so. Here's Petalmorphosis. So you're adding four cost, investing into one card, and maybe it'll go up by one or two and you draw a card. Super, super unreliable. Doesn't have any place really in any deck in the game. It's honestly not even that fun because usually when you play this on anything, it just turns into a one or two cost card. So useless. Pineclone. Pineclone will remain as, in my opinion, one of the best cards in the Kabloom class. Almost one of the reasons to go Kabloom. One of the few reasons. I'm going to put it in S tier because this you're able to make Pine Clone work with every single hero. There's so many combinations. I really think this is still a really underrated card in this game. Playing it with your Puff Shrooms, with your Shroom for Twos, with all of your little Swarm cards, including your Morph Spore from Solar Flare and Nightcap. 3/3 is a very hard stat to answer. Again, you have to sort of build a deck around it, but there's even some decks that are running like a couple of Pinecones just to make your early game cards that you're running in every single deck. You're running some early game minions, making them useful towards the mid to late game. Even had success running Pineclone like that. Love Pineclone. Sergeant Strongberry has been interesting. You don't actually, you know, you run this in Berry decks. This is sort of the heart and soul of Berry. When you have two of these, of course, it creates a Sergeant Strongberry loop that each of them sees each other doing damage, and it sort of does infinite damage to either a zombie or to the zombie hero until they block. Obviously got nerfed a lot when the block meter decided to shut down all damage once your opponent blocks. That was many years ago. I've actually had a little success just running this with Imitator, specifically. Imitator into Sergeant Strongberry means you'll have two, so that's a really cool combo, just another thing an Imitator does. And not even in a Berry deck, like, all you really need is Imitator, Sergeant Strongberry, and Berry Blast. And if you have that combo, that's going to end up doing, like, a humongous amount of damage. I'm going to put Sergeant Strongberry in B tier. Sonic Bloom as a finisher can be used, you know, in swarm decks or just as a finisher, sort of in any deck that maintains a lot of minions on the field. It's okay. I'll put it in C tier. I don't really run a ton of Sonic Bloom. It really has it's a very high cost card and has a very specific condition for it to be good. I would probably put it like this, you know. I would say Astro Shroom, the reason I'm putting it higher is because of Cycle Cat. But other than that, they probably would both be in C tier. It's a decent finisher in some decks. Sometimes it really saves, but it's hard to find a ton of decks that not only need a little bit of damage to reach in order to finish off, like an aggro deck, but also then runs a lot of minions. But sometimes it's really good. Usually you don't Usually you want your cards that are going to be getting them down to that last three or four damage. They're going to really maintain that tempo and aggression on the field, not just do it all in one burst because it's relying on other cards in order to be good. Sour Grapes, very weak field clear. There's a lot of even small cards. Most small cards even have more than one health, so not a super useful plant. It can be good with Sergeant Strongbeer in the field because then it's doing three to everything, but other than that, very hard to actually find uses out of Sour Grapes. In terms of its power, I'd probably put it in C, but in terms of how many decks it justifies a slot, especially as a four cost card, if you compare this to other four drops in this game, I'll put it in D tier, not a super useful card. Fig, we haven't really found the super competitive Fig deck. We're still looking for it. It actually has pretty very high stats for a four drop. Just think of this as something that basically trades with any zombie on turn four, then it turns into something random. It wins the trade and then you get something. So it's a trade winner. It sometimes ends up being a liability because if you play this on the field and they don't remove it, then any card you play subsequently after it can die to a bungee plumber, gets transformed basically by doing one damage. We mostly play this like with like hot lava decks and little splash like spit out splash decks with the Galactic Cactus. Competitively, man, I'd say it's probably better than these cards in D's. I'm putting in a low C tier. Atomic Bomb-O-Granite for a five cost card really doesn't do enough. The lanes that it needs on the both sides of it are, to get the two seedlings. You're not necessarily going to have this die with, no minions on either side of it. Even if there's a, even if you don't have any plants to the right of it, if there's a zombie to the right of it, when this dies and makes a seedling, that seedling dies for free. Obviously, we had a really cool moment with Atomic Bomb-O-Granite in the tournament, which I wasn't running. I got it from a fruitcake. We got seedling and it turned into a brainana, and the rest is history. But competitively, I mean, it's in D tier. If Bluesberry, just again, poor stats and a very poor ability, very hard to justify this as a card. I'll put it in D tier and running it actually in a deck. Electric Blueberry, it's unreliable ability, which is strong. The problem is it doesn't do the ability when it dies and it has no way of actually defending itself in its lane. Very, again, hard to justify running this as a five cost card. We try it every once in a while, it's not very good. I'll put it in D tier. I think the thing that would help this card is that if it did its ability even when it dies, like if this happened before combat here, I think this could actually be a viable card. I don't think it would be busted. I think that would make it actually a decent card because then it could possibly kill whatever they've played. Maybe it might go face, but it could actually kill the card that's played in front of it. Gloom Shroom is a card we've had a ton of success since we've been playing a lot of, again, these mid decks. We've been running Gloom Shroom as a good source of like damage in the late game, especially after since the Kabloom class, after you've set up your Pine Clones. Having five Bullseye just to slap on the field is really good. It's very versatile again because with little mushrooms, which Solar Flare and Nightcap have built-in mushrooms into their kit, into their superpowers. But especially if you're just running Puff Shroom and Shroom for two, which are anyway very good cards, this can get a ton of value. This can, even if it kills one minion, I mean, it's worth it because you're trading your tiny little minion and doing three damage to something, but every once in a while it's devastating. But even just the stats, five cost five, five bullseye is really good, especially if you're copying it with a with your imitators. I'm gonna put Gloomshroom. I've been loving Gloomshroom, man. I mean, even like Astrocado, which is one of the best cards in the freaking game, it's like sometimes I'll remove a couple of those just to run Gloomshroom. And I'll tell you the reason I'll put this in A rather than B, and this is the final thing, is that let me explain something to you. When you're running Solar Flare, you have a card, a superpower called Morph Spore that is absolute freaking garbage. It makes 2/1/1 mushrooms. If you're not running a Pine Clone deck or anything like that, that card just dies. Sometimes it can chump block something. This revives, this turns that card into 9 damage. So besides for, again, being a good card in itself, two of the heroes who actually have Gloomshroom, who can run Gloomshroom, 2 out of 4, also have Morph Spore, and it makes that absolutely trash card into a very good, very reliable source of field clear. Lava Guava, again, it does 2 damage in 3 lanes, and 2 damage doesn't really kill many things in this game. It also makes a hot lava, so kind of a jack of all trade field clear, but very hard to find a use for this actually running it in a deck. I'll put it in D tier. I won't yell at you if you run one or two, because sometimes, every once in a while, this can be super useful, but usually garbage. Sizzle is one of the absolute worst cards in the game. What were they thinking with Sizzle? You have a card in the Solar class that is Squash. Destroy a zombie. Doesn't matter how much health. Doesn't matter. This does five damage. What is five damage kill? What on turn five does five? Smashing Guard. Great. Who runs Smashing Guard? It's trash. It doesn't even kill cards that are its cost. Oh my gosh. It's so bad. It's a plant control card. It's so out. I mean, this costs five. Berry Blast does three damage. It costs two. Maybe if this could go face, this would actually be a good card, because you use it as a finisher. They gotta make Sizzle go face. That's all I'm trying to say, guys. But it's just so... It's not good in itself, and it's very outclassed by just about every single removal card in the game. And this is gonna just be the easiest F tier. Maybe I should make its own tier. You know what? Screw it. It's happening, guys. We're making a new tier. Where did it go? It's Sizzle tier. And then we'll make it gray, because it's complete garbage. Did it work? Oh no, wait, we have to delete this one. There. Oh no, I edited this. Okay, hold on. Guys, I'm very good at technical stuff. There. Then we add row below, and then we edit this one. You go purple, you go gray, your new name is Sizzle. I don't know why they... Yes, guys, we have Sizzle tier. I don't care. Next is Cherry Bomb. Very difficult to justify. This is a six cost card. Four damage, it's a lot, but the minions have to be close. I feel like if this did four damage in every lane, this could actually be decent, but not a very super good control card, because most of the cards they're running on turn 5 and 6 have more than 4 health anyway. I won't yell at you if you run these sometime, but practically speaking, D tier. Dandelion. Dandelion King we found, again, useful in like Dandelion OTK, where you play this into a Pear Paradise. Kind of a meme. You play this into Pear Paradise, they're down to 5 health then, because the first one does 10 damage, second... will cut their health further to 5 damage. The problem is this card gets blocked. You have to basically be doing no non-bullseye damage to their face, nor if this be reliable, because they have a full block meter, and your 6-cost card basically procs the block and is a 4-4. It's really, really garbage. This card should have bullseye. I think that actually would make this good. I don't think that would be too good. But yeah, Dandelion King, I mean, we'll put it in the same class as, like, useful in one deck. So we'll put it in C tier. Not a super good... We'll put in C tier. Not a super good card. Well, Sizzle's off the tier list, but I don't care. Doesn't deserve to be on. Poison Oak. Poison Oak is very high attack. It does 9 damage. I think it's the highest raw attack, and you know, naturally, without other cards buffing it in the game. You can use this if you're a budget player as a finisher. It's kind of like the only budget finisher that's a rare, but it doesn't really see a lot of use in high tier gameplay, because it's just stats, and it doesn't have very good stats when you put a zombie in front of it. I wonder if they just made this a 9-5, if that would just make it better, so it wins, it at least even trades against everything. I don't know why it's had to be anti-hero. Kind of useless. Yeah, I'd really like to see a Captain Combustible deck that reliably plays this in Time to Shines and does 9 damage, but otherwise, I'm going to put this in D tier. Not a good card. Grapes of Wrath, yeah. You know, we used to love doing Dandelion King on turn 6 and then Grapes of Wrath on 7. It's the more I've tried that over the years, the less it's been working. I think the game just kind of, usually games go fast. This isn't really like a reliable finisher. It's not very good stats for a 7-cost card, and then the damage... doing 6 is also not super reliable, because they can get blocked, or they could just chump luck the Grapes of Wrath with small zombies, and then it doesn't do a lot for a bunch of turns. I'll put it in D tier. Kernel Corn, on the other hand, now this is a card, because this has very high stats, 6-6, you know, that's like basically the base high stats in this game. And then it does 4 damage. You know, I've seen this card being played, and it absolutely just wins the game. I mean, this does 4 damage to every single zombie, so it's correcting trades, it's killing zombies outright. Plus, it's a 6/6 of its own beast. I haven't really been liking this card a lot. I know it's very expensive, but if you're able to maintain good control and healing, you're definitely able to use Kernel Corn. If you play Imitator on turn 7, you get double Kernel Corn. I'm going to put this, it's definitely not going to be up in A tier because, again, it's the amount of usefulness this has, it's kind of limited. But because of how impactful of a card, I'll actually put Kernel Corn in B tier. Again, it's very expensive, so there's a very specific types of decks that can be used. But honestly, even sticking this, a couple copies of these at the end of a deck, that, you know, curves out at turn 6, just in case you need a little bit more power for the late game to deal with a close match. I won't even yell at you if you do that, so I think it's a very versatile card. All right, guys, so that is the complete tier list for the Kabloom class of every single card, ranking from S to F. And hope you guys enjoyed. Don't run Sizzle, guys. I'll see you in the next tier list. Peace. This is Fry.